Did you know that the modern educational system, which is essentially the Prussian system, was instituted in order to get the populace to train them into unquestioned obedience to the ruler, to the state? That's its purpose. And for example, in Prussia, the principalities were not so, didn't have so much allegiance to the king, the ruler. So the objective was is to educate the children, compulsory education, so that they would just bypass the opinions of the principalities and produce a populace who had unquestioned obedience to the state. And the state controlled all education, state-controlled education. This is the purpose of it. It's also used to turn people's obedience away from the church, away from religion, to the state. And so we get statists, those whose religion is the state, actually. And this has been, of course, this has been used in history over and over and over. And it's been quite effective, actually, with disastrous results. Now, it's, for instance, Japan. Japan also copied the Prussian educational system, led to this incredible zombie-like, you know, obedience to the emperor. Certainly increased it. Nazis did the same thing. China has done, did much the same thing. Indoctrination, compulsory education, controlled by the state. It's a brainwashing is what it is. It's a brainwashing in the wrong direction. And so one must say, okay, what's the next virulence? Well, we already have it. We already have it. We're in the midst of it. We're in the midst of it. That is for sure. I've been doing a very informal exercise in the world with my antenna up, and it's been quite an education. I use two sports, baseball and football, and what I've done is I've just been, it's amazing what's happened. Everywhere I go, and everyone I interact with, somehow they will say, you know, football is what I really follow. Baseball, well, no, not really so much. I may pay a little attention, but football, yeah, this is great. Not even asking them. It's coming up now more and more and more. Without exception, I would say almost without, well, no, I can't, if I can think of any exception at all. Football is captured the attention of the American public, captured their attention. And I've been aware of this going on for, you know, a long time now. Baseball used to be king, and then football's come up. But now, it's captured the attention so that they can barely turn their attention over to baseball. They can hardly do it now anymore. It's amazing. Now, you might just shrug, say, oh, well, what's the big deal? It's a huge deal. It's a really huge deal as I talk about the world and the collapse of spiritual will towards, the collapse of will towards spiritual discernment coming up in July 15, 2016 is a nice date to keep in mind. This shows you what can happen is I say there's been a war taking place in this world for our attention, and there most certainly has. And when I say, what do you mean by that? Well, for a perfect example is the NFL, National Football League, or National Felons League, however you want to look at it, or No Fun League, or whatever. How it has managed to market itself as part of an overall campaign to sabotage spiritual discernment on this planet, and how successful it's been. Okay, how successful it's been. It's not just men, it's women too. They're also obsessed with football. Look at baseball, like, what is that? I've run into this a lot. Everywhere I go, I'm now aware, like, oh my gosh, these people are like total football fans. Even in the World Series, the Giants are in, I said, hey, you know, go Giants. And they'd say, what? Go 49ers. Like that. I said, what are you talking about? The Giants are in the World Series trying to be a dynasty. The 49ers just muddling along the middle of their season. No, 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 go 49ers. Football, 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 football. It's an obsession. Now, football is, of course, a very barbaric, it's a reflection of turmoil, chaos. What it does is watching football, it's extremely distracting. It interferes with spiritual discernment very severely. That's why it's been marketed so strongly. Now, baseball, on the other hand, or watching golf or something like that, not so much, not so much. You can take your attention off of it. You can wander away. You can come back. What inning is fifth inning? Or what's the score? Okay. Yeah, well, it doesn't seem to have the same effect at all on spiritual discernment. But football definitely has a very drastically negative effect on spiritual discernment. And it's become like a cult religion in the United States, and they're spreading it out throughout the world. Very good barometer. So I've been like taking the temperature, the barometer, pressure readings all over the place. It's quite astonishing. And every time I talk baseball, they'll talk a little bit and then say, well, how about those 49ers? You know, let's get our attention back to the 49ers, meaning that people no longer feel comfortable without their defenses against spiritual discernment. This is what I'm talking about, is a collapse of spiritual will, spiritual discernment on this planet. Is they will feel extremely exposed and frightened if they do not have this distraction, defense system of distraction operating and humming full blast. Like, oh, we're talking about something that's not so distracting. Whoa, wait a minute, let me get back to this. It's a defense reaction I'm noticing in people. Because talking baseball is easy to get philosophical, really, and you can even move it into spiritual. Whereas football, no. You know. So it's a very good defense against spiritual discernment. And people are again, I see immediate jitters. Like, oh my gosh, where's my fix? Where's my drugs? Where's my drugs? So it's a drug. Football's a drug, actually. A social drug. A very harmful social drug. And it is permeating our society to an extraordinary extent. It's like a cancer in our society. A horrible cancer. And I've done everything I can to try and keep people's attention off of football, actually. Failure. Complete failure. I mean, the sabotage work has been done expertly, as we expected it would be. But it's kind of shocking how well it's been done. You know, it absolutely is. Well, you have experts at work, unfortunately. Is this the best society, United States, Democratic society? Well, look what's happened. The whole country's been sabotaged down the drain. So if this is the best system there is, maybe we just better not have any system, you know? if this is the best way there is. Now, the best way there is to have those who have spiritual discernment. Know what the problem is, know what the solution to the problem is, and structure society in that way. That's the best system. Now, materialism, this system of the U.S. is great for capitalism, materialism, building defense systems, sabotaging spiritual discernment. This works great. Yeah, we know that. It works great. But keep in mind that the idea of separation of church and state, you have this this prescient educational system designed to indoctrinate everybody into unquestioned obedience to the state. Compulsory. To this attentional obedience to the state. How is that not interfering with church? How is that not interfering with church? It's compulsory, right? So basically you're saying compulsory indoctrination into unquestioned obedience of the state. How is that honoring separation of church and state? That's a rhetorical question, of course. Yeah. It's a total sham, of course. It's sabotage. So what I did was I tuned out. We didn't have television. My dad wouldn't allow it, which is great, great move on his part. Always thank him for that. And I tuned out school at an early age and just stopped paying any attention to it. And started studying spiritual books and teachings. And tried to start get liberated from this insanity here as you come into this world. People demand explanations. And of course, reality requires no explanations. And they think, no, we have to have a very good explanation to get back to. No, we don't. And most of us fall down and get trapped in our minds and our thinking. Then we need to work to get free of that. School doesn't help us at all with that. In fact, that's not the goal of any education in this world, really. Except, of course, you're talking, you know, monastic education and that is training to help us move our comfort zone to liberation. But, of course, that's the obvious exception to it. So the world does not have the tools to succeed. The world does not have the tools to succeed. They've been told that at all costs, stay away from those tools, at all costs. That to look in that direction is a complete disaster for you and for everybody. And so they're all, you know, we're all obedient to that. And of course, the modern school system is designed by corporations, supported by corporations. It's basically unquestioning obedience to corporate culture. The state is really just an extension of corporate culture, which is, of course, materialism. Now, one thing that's very important is do not get over the house proudness. You know, this is an obsession in the world, isn't it? Pride in your house. What can you do with your house? How can you make your house better? Just give me, you know, four concrete walls or four gray walls or just something simple, basic. Just sheetrock. Or, you know, just a desk, and this is monastic, right? And when you get over your house proudness, then you're not frightened of just some simple dwelling place. It's actually very helpful not to think about it at all. Same thing with shopping. I'm sick and tired of shopping. I don't want to buy anything anymore. I'm finished with buying stuff. If I ever go into a Home Depot again, I think I'm going to scream. I've been in there thousands and thousands of times. It's just like, oh, not again, please. Going to the stores is just so horrible now. So I've sort of worked through the whole shopping thing, buying things, getting things. Don't need to buy anything, don't need to get anything. All we need to get is that there's nothing to get. That's what we need to get. Right? We need to get that there's nothing to get. I'm not a body, I'm free, I'm still spirit as God created me, there's nothing to get. So, as you go along, the Holy Spirit helps you in your valuing of the world, Jesus. One second. has advised me, examine your valuing of the world. Spend your time examining your valuing of the world. Okay, so I did that. Been there, done that. And, you know, the result is I don't feel any need or desire to go into any store and buy anything. Now, this is far cry from what corporate culture wants, isn't it? Phase of that, the last 20 years, actually. Consciously working on what I thought had value, and then recognizing, like, wait a minute, you know, gradually you realize this doesn't really have any value. It's not worth imagining myself to be unalive in order to value this, you know. It's not worth all the fear and the terror and the confusion and chaos and despair and all this, just so I can feel like I can value something like that. So imagine a life you don't have to buy anything. How great would that be? You don't have to buy anything. You don't have to go buy stuff. Now, that might freak almost everybody out, right? But for me, it doesn't freak me out at all. I say, hey, great. Now I can really focus in. You know, just relentlessly move the comfort zone. That's great. Don't have to garden. That's great. Don't have to clean up, that's great. Don't have to worry about, you know, how my house looks to somebody, that's great. Or, you know, don't have to impress people, that's great. So it's like monastic living. This is something that is the Holy Spirit helped me with this, most certainly. Overcoming your value of the world, overcoming your value of the world, bit by bit by bit by bit. And you're really no longer interested in any of that. But for a while, I certainly was. I just got into it, you know, and just You didn't even have to buy anything, like shopping for shoes or something. There's hundreds of kinds of tennis shoes and stuff. And wow, look at this one, maybe this one, this one. It's addictive. But, you know, eventually you just say, wow, that's enough. I'm no longer interested in that. I noticed something very interesting also. Recently, there's been a number of instances where the television has been on somewhere, and I wasn't paying attention to it, but just walking through the room or something. What they're doing now is they're plastering in big lettering about the shocking thing they're talking about. They've got it up there. You know, hideous, 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 gruesome this. And so even if you mute it, you see, which I make sure, I try to mute TVs, whatever it is, a muted TV is a good TV, you're still seeing the headline. They used to have little tickers down below where you could read it. Now they put it in real big letters, so even if it's muted, or there's a conversation going on, the glaring gruesomeness in the headline is there, plastered on the screen, you see. So I said, wow. That's even more hardcore. You see how they're doing? Very offensive. So you can't even mute it and escape the content what they're blabbing about. The saboteurs. Media are very much saboteurs here on this planet. That's why people don't like them. Good for good reason. What are they doing? They're sabotaging spiritual discernment. What else is there to sabotage? I mean, that's what people are afraid of. That's what the continuity fear is afraid of, is spiritual discernment. Saying, hey, wait a minute. There has never been any even an instant of existence. All is God. I am God. All is God. I am God. All is God. There's never an instant where that is not true. All is bliss, all is freedom, all is love, all is joy, all is perfect. There's no time, space, process, or form. This is spiritual discernment, and continuity fear is terrified of that. So what it does is it sabotages spiritual discernment, which is an attentional issue. It tries to demonize it. Frighten you, taboo it, you know, they cannot put your attention there and give you an alternative to put your attention onto. It's classical conditioning, is you want someone to change their behavior, give them a somewhat parallel behavior that's not quite the same and get them onto that. So it's really basically comfort zone, moving your comfort zone away from spiritual discernment, whereas what we're doing is moving our comfort zone towards spiritual discernment, greater and greater spiritual discernment. Both, you see, use the similarity of moving the comfort zone, classical conditioning, as you give yourself, they would give them, you know, something, hey, you know, try this spirituality out. And it's similar to, it's not non-dual, but it's got some of the similar terminology, and it might be like this, try this out, and you try that out, and then they give you something else, like a little more off track, and gradually, just like Fabian socialism, they take you off track. Fabian was a famous Roman general that basically defeated Hannibal back in the Punic Wars by never engaging directly in a direct battle with Hannibal, which was, those who'd done that was disastrous. So he simply gradual attrition, avoided any direct battles. It's Fabianism, and it's Fabian socialism. It's creeping, gradual. You creep, move the goalposts. This is what's happening in the world. This is what the saboteurs are doing, is they gradually move our comfort zone farther and farther away from spiritual discernment. And you hardly even notice it. There's a problem. It's so gradual. But keep in mind, if we can have gradually moved our attention off of spiritual discernment, so much so that we hardly even notice what's happening, we can also gradually move it back with hardly even noticing too, right? It's not a problem. Keep that in mind. Keep that in mind as you go on with your moments and moments and moments of believing that somehow you've changed reality or something which is not true, that you've somehow positioned yourself in a disadvantageous position is not true. Keep in mind that the only problem you have is a continuity problem, and the cure is to gradually move your comfort zone, evaporate, you know, I call it evaporating the continuity fear, moving your comfort zone gradually. You moved it out of spiritual discernment gradually, you can move it back. Absolutely you can. But of course it takes time. So what these Fabian saboteurs do is to tell you that the only way to get enlightened is you gotta instantly, you have to do it right now. You can't take any time to do it. They tell you this, which is not true at all, of course. Because then you say, well, I can't do it. It's too difficult. And they say, well, you can't take any time doing it because, I mean, how did you lose your discernment? You must have lost that right away. And you think, well, how did I lose it? I don't really know. Maybe it just happened all at once. I need to get it back all at once or something. Not realizing that you have gradually moved, okay, your comfort zone away from spiritual discernment. So, of course, you have to gradually move it back again. You cannot just do it all at once. And this does not counter Ati Yoga, like Longchenpa, of the quantum leap, the leap of faith, understanding there's nothing to get. But you have to gradually realize, get to the point where you're able to, your comfort zone is there, and you can realize that nothing's ever happened. And we've talked about this in other videos. So you get trapped into thinking that somehow you're supposed to be able to do it instantly. And this is what keeps people really trapped. That's why I say that the way to get untrapped is to realize you only have one problem, and that's a continuity problem. This is the answer. This is the key to success. So just as it may have taken, you know, you've spent your lifetime moving your comfort zone away from spiritual discernment, bit by bit by bit by bit, television program by television program, you know, moving away, you spend a lifetime moving your comfort zone back to spiritual discernment. And of course, as you start having success, that will motivate you, keep you going, and say, wow, I can't quit. This is really going to work for me. Now, I've also said that there are like four basic stages. So in the fourth phase, you're able to say, hey, there's never been even an instant of existence. And you've got your comfort zone there. And at that point, there's like a non-quantum, non-leap. At least that's how I'm preparing for it in some way, of just, you know, somehow all effort ceases, all seeking, all attempts to get it cease. You know, there's just acceptance of relaxing into realizing it never moved anywhere, never went anywhere. No one's ever gone anywhere. Nothing has ever happened at all. Nothing has ever happened at all. Nothing will ever happen. This discernment requires you moving your comfort zone so you're comfortable with it. If you believe that this discernment is going to be your annihilation, then of course you're not going to be comfortable, and you're going to do everything you can to stay away from it. So you will embrace this world and its conditioning and its defensiveness. Defensiveness is always against spiritual discernment. And you see more and more and more and more and more that being saturated, this culture with spaz-like reactions, especially by younger people, but it's trickling into older people, where put a camera on, they just do some spaz out, emotional spastic reaction or something, and everybody say, hey, that's cool, I can be a spaz too, you know, something that just, you know, totally whimsically animalistic, that just sort of jars you. It's like that. This is more and more, everybody's saying, oh, that's funny, that's cute, that's fun, that's great, let's do that. And, you know, that ties in with the NFL, ties in with all the comic books and the superhero movies and all this, you know, all this heavy emphasis on the body and reacting in ridiculous ways, you know, stuff like that, instead of this calm, poised, contemplative, meditative condition, which is what is helpful to moving our comfort zone into greater and greater spiritual discernment. We sort of have a comic book culture at this time, actually, very much so. And of course, there's no absolute judgment on anything from God whatsoever. That's not the point. We have a severe continuity problem. So we have a pragmatic situation here. So from that standpoint, there's absolutely what is helpful and what is not helpful. Absolutely there is. You want to emphasize one and de-emphasize the other. What do you want to see? Some spastic, you know, talk show host just acting like a complete spaz? Or do you want to see some spiritual master in composed contemplation, meditation, and talking? You know, what's more effective? In freeing you from misery? I want to start a channel on Muji TV. I do Muji TV. I said, you know, the idea was you should have channels. How many channels do we have available now? 1,000? I think probably a lot more in some sense. I don't know. But can we not have one channel that is dedicated to spiritual depths? I mean, there's enough videos. You know, you can have Muji TV or a Muji channel on television, for example. Just for example. I'm not trying to endorse or not endorse or push or not push or anything. I'm just saying this example. Busy, certainly very watchable and entertaining. I haven't watched him in quite some time, but when I was, he's you know, certainly you're not going to get bored, right? So a lot of people on YouTube are just, you know, spend their time watching. This is what we do, this is what I do, trying to find, but it's difficult. It's difficult to find a cool program. One of my dreams of this life was to start a TV channel, you know, and to have my own TV channel put on spiritual discernment programming. There is no such channel in the world, really. And several people have sort of tried that. They tried to put together something on YouTube and said, but I'm talking about a TV channel, you know, reaches all over the world. Anybody with dish or satellite or cable can keep that on. And you walk through your kitchen, instead of having some news show with some gruesome headline on it, you have the teacher is talking about non-duality. You can see how composed they are, how blissful they are. You say, wow, that's helpful. That just moved my comfort zone. You see, moving your comfort zone is a day-to-day, instant-by-instant situation. You have pictures of saints up, you have pictures of sages, you have things that help tune you into peace, you know, spiritual discernment. You have, if you want to have a television on, you have a spiritual channel, spiritual discernment channel on. All this stuff, I said, wow, what a great opportunity. And I've slaved my whole life to try and come up with this and completely failed, really. And this is the only thing I've been able to do. It's just, it's incredible how it's not supported. I think there's almost like 2,000 videos on this channel right now. Certainly enough for some programming, but I would want the content to be even higher than this content. That's for sure. spiritual masters, you know, say absolute sages. You know, there's videos of some of them, and but all that content from the great masters and sages being presented in a video format that we could have on the big screen, the big high definition flat screens we have now. Just have it going 24/7 in your house. This is my dream. This is what I tried to do. I spent my life working on trying to develop awareness of this. I tried to do it with Sri Anand Mahamaya and her pictures or videos, trying to get people interested in, you know, let's make a channel out of this. Let's have this going in people's homes all over the world. So satsang, darshan, you know, didn't go anywhere. I spent all my time and money and effort and all that. So complete fiasco. So this shows to the world, and even though the capability of doing this is here, there's no will to do it. There's not enough spiritual discernment to do it. People are simply not interested. They are interested in moving their comfort zone away from spiritual discernment. Being very cleverly led down the primrose path. But of course we cannot spend all our time focused on this. It's very difficult. But as you move about your life, you should have on your, for instance, on it when I drive the radio. There's nothing I can listen to on the radio now. Nothing. Absolutely nothing. Have a radio station that gives the talks of these sages. They just punch the radio station. There it is. You don't have to have a bunch of high gadgets and technology. Just a radio station. When you're home, you can have a big screen on with the spiritual discernment station. Have books that are sitting around that when you sit down to relax, oh, there's a book right here, let me open it up and read some, like that. I have all these books right by my computer. I have Journey Beyond Words, Course in Miracles, You Are the Splendor and Spaciousness, The Radical Zazen of Longchenpa, of the Vajra Heart, Dharma Dhatu, Precious Treasure of the Dharma Dhatu by Longchenpa. I have those four books are like right by my computer, so any moment I have a lag, I can just open up one of these books and start, you know, reading it. But for some reason, this just hasn't. You know, it would be so easy to produce stuff for listening to the radio. So I was unable to get any interest in the world. I had reproducers for CDs, for videos, for everything. I set it all up, no interest, zero interest. Amazing. And I know that people who try to do this just find it's an insufficient interest. They're overwhelmed. So have to push the reset button in some other time, place, situation where that's what will be available, period. You know, the other stuff won't even be available. How it used to be in this world, that only religious motifs could be used. That's what you have to reset. Hit the reset. We've already found out how we tend to find the distractions irresistible. But of course, because of our severe continuity fear, the distractions seem irresistible to us. Even the best of us can hardly resist. The graphics, everything's so groovy. And it's just like, wow, candy store, you know. So that has to be ruled out. It's proven. It's been proven to me, beyond any doubt, that the way to help others is to just exclude that stuff. It has to be excluded. This whole nonsense of multitasking and how, no, don't worry, we can have it all, you know, is of course nonsense. It's an abject failure in this world. balancing so many things. Oh, a little bit of this, a little bit. That's okay. This. No, it's been a huge failure. Huge failure. In fact, coming to this world is like a study in failure and seeing what doesn't work. Seeing what doesn't work. So the next opportunity for those who want it will be something we will certainly focus on what does work. What does work. But trying to make it work here in this world, I don't see how that's even remotely possible. So, at some point, if there are any quote-unquote channels at all, it'll be only spiritual discernment channels, only that. You have to give up the other stuff. It's been proven that we are way too vulnerable for that. And those who claim that we can do it all actually are professional saboteurs. This is what I've seen. And it's very clever how they do it, as I pointed out in numerous videos, how this sabotage this planet has, how has it happened? And I don't know if I need to go over and over and over again, because people are probably, they're tired and they don't want to hear about it because it bothers them, you know, because we have these sacred cows. We can't say anything negative about these sacred cows. And people say, how can I function in the future if I don't show that I'm very much worshipful of these sacred cows in the world? But they're saboteurs. The sacred cows in this world are saboteurs. Who basically said, if you criticize me, then you're wicked, you're evil, you don't dare suggest that what I'm doing, you're discriminating, you're repressing, or this, that. So then they can say, hey, you can do it all. And if someone says, no, you can't, and they say, you're undermining my self-esteem or something, you're trying to prevent me from expressing my greatness, you know, and helping the world and all this kind of stuff. And this is what has happened. It is the culture of victimization that has arisen, where the saboteurs claim if you point out what they're doing, you're sabotaging their sabotage. And are you preventing their sabotage, which is, then they'd say that you're being repressing them, trying to restrict them, you know, that kind of all this crying and wailing and excuses they make. And it's been entirely successful, actually. And we knew this was coming. I've seen it all the way coming through. I said, wow, if you don't stop it now, you won't be able to stop it later. People didn't stop it then, so it's not stoppable now, that's for sure. And it's pretty amazing. When this recent election just happened, midterm election happened, what happened was, suddenly, there was this immediate defensive reaction from corporate establishment and this defensive system of the world. Immediately shifting attention to, okay, folks, here's our plan now to deal with this. And of course, it shifted on to the sob sisters and the saboteurs who are so expert at making you feel guilty and bad about saying no to them, saying, no, you're wrong. How can you say I'm wrong? I'm just, you know, you're trying to, you know, prevent me from growing in influence, and it's our right to have influence because you've repressed us for so long, and all, you know, all these sob stories are so good at. That's emotional instead of reason-based, you know, undermining your resolve like that, as if somehow you're an evil, wicked, repressive, you know, person who's trying to hold back their fulfillment and happiness and discredit, not giving them a sufficient due and all these things. Okay, it's all sabotage. This is a whole mentality of sabotage in this planet. We don't have a progression in this planet. We have a sabotage that's going into the dumpster. And many have known this, and of course they've been clamoring against it. But this, of course, the saboteurs turn a deaf ear to that and just claim that they're old-fashioned, repressive, what do you call all the negative words they use? Bigoted, intolerant, prejudiced, you know, it's on and on and on and on. This is what the saboteurs say. So this is what has happened, is there was a backlash, and now they say, wow, we've got to pull out the heavy artillery now. And if you know, it's amazing what I've noticed. Wikipedia is very biased, I've noticed this. I spent a lot of time going through Wikipedia, evaluating it. It's very interesting how what this progressivism, which a progressive feminism is a way to call this sabotage, actually. It's being done, dressed up in a skirt, and saying if you say no, you're criticizing the mother, you know, or something, that you're being evil. But the Wikipedia is very, 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 very much laced with sabotage. Tremendous amount of revisionism in it. Very biased, very progressive, very slanted towards the saboteurs in this world in a lot of subtle ways. It's laced with it, actually. Pretty amazing. Very biased. But it's done very subtly and gently, and you know, they're very tricky, very, very tricky how they do it. And it probably fools a lot of people. Google had a Veterans Day. Google Doodle on their search page was honoring the military. Okay, this was just after these elections happened, everything. So honoring the military, what do they do? They have front and center, standing out front and center of this graphic, and all the other military personnel in the background like this. And what do they have? They have a cadet, all dressed up in like this very pride of motherhood in America and everything, snappy suit and just everything was just spit and polished, beautiful, you know, cadets. As a woman, of course, on Veterans Day, representing veterans, military. I said, and all the men were like fuzzy in the background, indeterminate, sort of fuzzy. The woman is the new face of the veterans now. Yeah, they're the ones who have fought all the battles. Okay. Just another example of what's going on. There's just thousands and millions of these subtle shifts of comfort zone like this. Saying, don't worry about losing spiritual discernment. You'll be so smart and multitasking and compassionate and what do you call, you know, have all these virtues that you'll be able to do that too. That's not a problem. You just have to go along this way. You go along this way. And at some point you'll be feel so wonderful, as I say, to live in this corporate goddess cult, that you'll feel so privileged to be able to do anything you want to. So if you want a spiritual discernment, realize nothing's ever existed. It's easy. You'll be able to do anything. You'll be so superior. You'll be part of the super race, this golden age, this fake golden age. It's a fake golden age. Yeah, it's no problem. This is the lie. This is the big lie that is infiltrating our planet and is literally creeping into every last. It's amazing how I'm noticing on Wikipedia articles, those who are writing are now twisting it and slanting it to the corporate goddess cult. Most definitely. They're all in on this. They are all in on this, and it's subtle creeping Fabianism, okay, that moves your comfort zone bit by bit by bit. You get used to reading these articles, and you see something like, wait a minute, why is this being emphasized as something so important? You know, it's the goddess cult, the corporate goddess cult is putting this ideal of the woman of supposing saying that, don't worry, when you're under this umbrella of gentleness and sweetness and compassion and beauty and you know, the mother is so nice, you'll be able to do anything. You won't have any problems. You won't have a problem with enlightenment. You want enlightenment? Sure, no problem. And so we say, oh, okay, yeah, just be super multitasking, and I can spend all day watching football, and then I can, you know, drink a lot of alcohol and coffee, and I can do that, and then, oh yeah, okay, so now enlightenment, sure, can do that too. Where's the enlightenment pill? I can have that too. And so this is the big lie that has been brought into this world. There's no question about it. And you can't just do it like that, you see. That's the big lie, because it's a continuity issue. It's a familiarity issue. You can't take a pill and cure a familiarity issue. You can't go to a store and buy something that cures a familiarity issue, problem. You can't multitask a familiarity problem away like that. You can't say, gee, I'm so empowered, I can now just toss aside a familiarity issue, a severe, incredibly severe. There is simply no way you can do that. So we have been hoodwinked and lied to and deceived and seduced by these saboteurs, cosmic colonialists, I call them. Took our eye off the prize, and now we're in, you know, the world's in huge collapse, trouble, spiritual will, collapse of spiritual will on this planet. So, noticing all this, and you know what to avoid in the future, that is for sure. This is what historically religions have avoided, this, tried to avoid this, what's happened. Because this is the type of sabotage that's been used over and over and over in the cosmos. Same old, same old, same old, same old. That's why they're so good at it. They've had a lot of practice, actually. A lot of practice. They, meaning the unrepentant ones, who are still trying desperately to be greater than God and have not yet repented and feel that somehow God will never let them back into heaven, which is ridiculous because they never left. The fact is, they can't leave. So what they really mean is that their continuity fear is so severe they'll never be able to evaporate it, which is not true. See, that's why I'm able to say what I'm able to say, is because I know they can evaporate their continuity fear. No question about it, even the worst of them. And they will. At some point, they absolutely will. No one will be lost. No one will be lost. Of course, they're the ones who promulgated the whole ridiculous notion of the sinners who don't repent being cast down and burned in hell forever and tortured and tormented endlessly and then annihilated. They're the very ones who brought this nonsense, also infiltrated that, which is not true, so that we'd feel sorry for them. And so that's not fair. They say, hey, look, do you really think that just asking you to move your comfort zone just a little bit like this, is that really reason for me to be tortured forever and burned in hell forever and then annihilated? Is that, do you think that's right? And you say, well, no, that's ridiculous. I say, well, okay. I mean, well, that, but so let's move the comfort zone a little bit here. You know, I'm not so bad, right? And they say, oh, yeah, I'm only asking a little thing, right? I say, oh, yeah, but they're not asking a little thing. They're asking you to accept that moving your comfort zone away from spiritual discernment, bit by bit by bit by bit by bit, is a good thing for you. And it's not. It's a horrible thing. They always say, well, just this once, and then again, a little bit more, a little bit more, day, like that. This is their goal. This is their agenda. So they're not asking you another thing. They're asking you to do a terrible thing bit by bit. That's still terrible. See, this is the lie that they pass through. They try to get you focused on, well, just a little bit at a time, instead of the overall picture. Well, where are we going with this? What's the upshot of this? What's the end game of this? Oh, to sabotage spiritual discernment is their game. And that is not a little thing. It's a very big, it's the only issue there really is. So they're anti-Christ, countering Christ, which is moving your comfort zone, bit by bit, to greater and greater spiritual discernment, which eventually be able to discern that, hey, I never left the perfectly non-dual singularity, oneness of reality. All is one, all is perfect. No one's ever left. It's impossible. You can't leave. Existence never happened. Eventually you can get to that. So they are, see how tricky they are. It's very tricky. They say, we don't deserve any. Now, even though what they're asking to do is sabotage the spiritual discernment, still, they cannot get free of reality. They're just as much one with reality as anyone else. So, they cannot be annihilated or burned in hell forever. It's impossible. They have to overcome their continuity of fear too. So you're not doing them any favors by going along with this. That just increases the guilt. You say, you see, you went along with this, that makes you feel even more guilty. I may be burned in hell even worse because you went along and say, oh no, I feel terrible about that. Okay, well just move a little bit more like that and I'll feel better about that and that'll help me. Oh, you poor thing, you know, okay. They play on this sympathy, they play on this like that. Very cynical and adept at doing that. A little lost orphan who God has rejected, you know, who's going to be burned in hell forever, and they say, you know, is that really right? God's so mean, and it plays on the mother instinct, so to speak. We feel like, not just for females and males too, the mother instinct of, oh my God, let me take care of this, you know. This one who's been rejected, the one who's been rejected. Let me help them. That's not right. That's too cruel. That's so cruel. You know. And you get suckered into that. They're lying. Okay, they don't have the spiritual discernment to say that they're going to be annihilated or tortured and in hell forever. They don't have any such spiritual discernment. So how can you believe what they're saying? They're making that up to make you feel sorry for them so that you will then say, fall into their trap of, hey, let's make this world a great place so we can all be happy and let all get along together and let's exclude this cruel, angry, vindictive God who wants to destroy us and punish us. It's not right. It's, you know, let's just work on making this world a great place. So this is what has happened to this planet. This is what we were warned about. We were told about 2,000 years ago. So you better get up ahead of steam because this is what's going to happen to this planet for sure. And it has already happened. This is exactly what we were told is going to happen, and it happened. This is something that's happened to many planets in the cosmos, actually. And of course, those who are skilled in this guilt will just keep using that and say, oh, you're putting me down. I've done such a terrible thing. I'm going to be punished so terribly. You're going to repress me so terribly. I have no say anymore forever. And that's not fair. Can you not at least, you know, blah, 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 blah. No, it's not. What you do is what everyone does, is you go into a retreat and evaporate the continuity fear just like everybody else. There's no exceptions or exemptions. And certainly, I say, well, yeah, but I want to be in charge. I'm used to be. No, you can't. Those who have no spiritual discernment cannot be in charge of the path of spiritual discernment. Of course not. Well, you're discriminating. No, you have a severe problem. We're therapists helping you. We're not discriminating. Yeah, but yeah, I'm used. No, no exceptions or exemptions. As I keep trying to play the guilt card like that, so. So this cancer, this virus continues throughout the cosmos like this. Oh, these poor underdogs, they haven't been treated properly, they've been blah, blah, blah. No, they've just been trying to be greater than God. And they don't have this severe continuity fear, like everybody has a severe. Thank you. sympathy here. I can't do it. It's not possible to do it. Someone's asked me to do something that's not possible, or it's not fair, that it's too difficult. And I'm too much of an underdog here. I never succeed, blah, blah, blah. None of that's true. You have to turn a deaf ear to that. No exceptions, no exemptions. Pure, unequivocal, no exceptions, no exemptions. No one's exempt, no exceptions. Everyone is God. All is God. There's nothing outside of God whatsoever. Never has been, never will be. So those who claim that somehow they've been so bad that they can't go back, there's no going back, they never left. They have no choice. So it takes spiritual masters who don't fall for this guilt trip, you know, to have the spiritual discernment to set things up properly. It really does. It's a very, very, very vicious trap. A Course in Miracles was for teachers of God. Jesus said some are appointed to be teachers of God at this, you know, going forward. And so here's the course to get ready for that. Well, yeah, it takes the capacity to to stop mid-sentence. It takes the capacity to stop mid-sentence. Because the burn and jitters are here, so just let them be here. Because what's being said here is like sacrilege to the world, absolute sacrilege. Because it's really speaking to the heart of the whole routine that's been used for so long throughout the cosmos. It's not fair, it's not fair, it's not fair. God isn't treating me fair. You can do better than God by treating me fair. If you treat me fair, I'm going to look at you and say you're greater than God because God's not fair, you know, this kind of thing. You know, seduction through guilt and all that stuff. God can't help but be perfectly fair. It's impossible not to be. So what they're saying is, God is too fair. God is too fair. I want God to be unfair. I've worked so hard for God to be unfair, and God's still not unfair. That's not fair. Yeah, like that. You have no choice. You have no choice. I say, well, I'm going to hold my breath forever. I say, well, good luck with that. I have to attend to a few chores and stuff. So this is very intense, though. I'll give it a few more moments because the burn here is very intense. We don't have to be slaves to the clock. This is another thing about this culture here. Is why not be 10 minutes late? Why not be, why not take a stop, a break here? So what's more important? Moving the comfort zone is what's important. Talk and bring the sabotage clear and clear and clear, we become more and more aware of what we need to do to help. There are those who insist they're beyond help and that it's not fair, and the only way to help them is to sort of build another reality for them, help construct another reality where they can live forever, otherwise they'll be damned forever, and you know, nonsense. They will get very tired and bored of delusion eventually. No exceptions. You don't let the fox into the hen house. You don't let the wolf into the sheepfold. You don't let saboteurs into the monasteries, for instance. You don't allow them to run the show. You don't let the inmates run the asylum. And what you have here is inmates saying, "Hey, well, we can't get well. We're beyond help. So it's unfair to keep treating us and giving us therapy. In fact, what you need to do is help make things as good as possible for us and make us happy by listening to what we want say is what makes us happy. This makes us happy, and do that, because we can't get back to God because we've been too hateful towards God, and it's not possible, and we don't, you know, blah 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 blah. Continuity fear is too severe. There's no way I can resolve it." Not true at all. Absolutely, everyone can take the path and must of moving their comfort zone, just as they moved it bit by bit away, move it bit by bit back. It may seem impossible. It's not. Holy Spirit is there to help us every step of the way. It is absolutely assured, as a matter of fact. The Holy Spirit actually sees everyone as cured, because it's able to see the entire path of everyone all the way to the end. Right now, it's aware that we're all cured. We are all cured. And that is a fact. All right? And again, discernment is discerning a tremendous reaction to this. Psychic response. All these psychics that we have in the world, they're confusing the issue for sure. Getting in touch with your feelings. Oh, I'm feeling. No, that's not it. That's not it at all. This is a reaction to realize we're all cured already. We're already cured. The Holy Spirit sees us all as cured. Literally, it sees the end. Right now, we stand as cured in the mind of the Holy Spirit as a fact. See, it's a different kind of response we get from this than all this other stuff. Nonsense. This is like a genuine wow. Heavy duty wow. This world's so much into the psychic, it's ridiculous, and that confuses everything. Leave out all the powers, the cities, all the powers, the psychic stuff, this, and that. Forget about it. Worthless dross. Everybody stands cured. Super important to see that. Vision of oneness. Then you won't be fooled by these people who claim they can't be cured, because you see they're already cured. They have been cured. Holy Spirit has already cured them. This is a fact. The Holy Spirit has already cured everyone of the continuity problem. It's already accomplished. See, now this is hitting very strong. Landscape has shifted. So ask the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, show me what you see. Show me what you see. Show me this, so I need not worry anymore. You know, talk to the Holy Spirit. Ask the Holy Spirit. keep trying. Show me this so that I may know. Show me this so that I may know. And continue your full stop in the burn, which is the ultimate of spiritual practice. It's like so you're sitting there and suddenly someone just plopped down a mountain of gold in front of you. It's like that. Really? And you might say, oh, there's a mountain of gold. And superficially you pretend like nothing. Okay, it's fine, a mountain of gold is here. But deep down it's reverberating like, oh my gosh. Wow. This is just stupendous. So be aware of the stupendousness of what's going on here. The sacredness called stupendousness, absolutely stupendous, staggering. And let that be felt. Let that be felt. Stupendously staggered by this. Stupendous, be stupendously staggered. Is keep your spiritual practice going until you reach this stupendously staggered, and then you know you've had a very good practice. So I'm supposed to go do something, but I say just wait a few minutes here, don't rush it. Staggered. Because this is important in so many ways. Knocks the guilt out. You know, it's liberating, tremendously liberating. If you see everyone is already cured, all the lies and deceit and guilt and say, no, I can't be cured. You have to help. Therefore, you must adjust, you know. It's not true. Okay, very great.